case for disaggregated storage. In today's hyper-converged infrastructure, compute and storage are aggregated in a server. The storage is attached to the compute in what is called a direct attached storage or DAS model. The converged DAS model worked well when storage protocols were slow and requirements for capacity were modest. Storage was placed near compute elements. Throughput and capacity were mainly constrained by the available slots in a server and storage media technology. Today, modern workloads demand storage requirements beyond what can be supported in a DAS model. And more importantly, storage protocols have become so fast and efficient that storage no longer needs to be placed near compute elements. These trends are driving the disaggregation of storage. Disaggregating storage involves taking away all the storage from the compute servers and grouping them together in a storage pool. Physically, multiple compute and storage elements may be housed in separate compute and storage servers. So, what are the requirements to effectively disaggregate your storage? The commercialization of fast and modern SSDs opened up a slew of new use models and applications. However, the original protocols supporting SSDs, such as SAS and SATA, were archaic and inefficient. There is a need for an efficient protocol to communicate between the compute and storage nodes in a disaggregated model. With the introduction of fast and efficient protocols such as NVMe and NVMe over fabric to support cross-fabric interconnectivity, high-performing, low-latency SSD storage can now be disaggregated outside of compute servers and accessed at latencies that rival a direct-attached storage model. Next is the need for a fast anywhere-to-anywhere network so that all the compute nodes can access storage very quickly. This is called a network fabric. A storage node is commonly called a storage array and logically is made of a bunch of SSDs managed by a controller. It is crucial for the controller to be able to process data and access the SSDs at the maximum bandwidth and the lowest latencies for which the aggregated SSDs are capable of. And that bandwidth needs to be pretty high to accommodate high-demand content, where a large number of compute nodes are attempting to access the same content simultaneously. Now, what are the benefits of disaggregated storage compared to the traditional direct-attached storage? Today's modern workloads demonstrate two attributes. First, modern workloads have a need for different hardware requirements. Some are compute-heavy, some others are storage-heavy. Second, they can be really huge. Further, at different times of the day, the distribution of workload types may vary significantly. By disaggregating storage and then by pooling them virtually, you can now create and manage larger shared datasets. These datasets, enabled by ample bandwidth, allow a huge number of compute nodes to tap into them to perform computations and gather insights, otherwise limited by the traditional DAS model. To cater for the varied workloads, one possible solution is to over-dimension your hardware to fit the largest requirement. This, of course, is an expensive and wasteful solution as storage servers are underutilized. The second possible solution is to offer a menu of server variants. Deployment and management of servers become complex, especially when the number of permutations within the servers increase. In contrast, with a disaggregated approach, you can now design simpler compute and storage nodes. Server nodes can be homogeneous, and pools of interconnected compute and storage resources can be flexibly apportioned to workloads. Further, you now have the flexibility to upgrade, replace, or add specific resources instead of entire systems. This pay-as-you-grow planning allows for easier infrastructure management and better budget control. In the DAS model, whenever you need to migrate workloads, you move the data from one server to another. With a disaggregated approach, because there is no state in a server, there is no need to migrate workloads or move data. This stateless model is great for fault tolerance, scalability, and live deployment. Disaggregated storage also lets you take advantage of the inherent benefits of scale-out architecture. If one of the storage nodes fails, data integrity can be protected by using techniques such as replication or erasure coding. These techniques are most effective when the storage nodes are geographically distributed. Here's a summary of the benefits of disaggregating storage. Supports resource pooling to fit applications with large datasets. Enables on-demand infrastructure, right-sized, flexible, and composable. Improves reliability and durability of storage servers. And all these benefits lead to lower TCO in both CapEx and OpEx. At Fungible, we are putting together all the ingredients required to enable disaggregated storage. One key technology is a data-centric engine known as the Data Processing Unit, or DPU. The DPU enables a super-fast anywhere-to-anywhere, low-latency and tail-latency fabric. supports NVMe and NVMe over fabric storage protocols, serves as a powerful controller for vending SSDs to the network without loss of bandwidth, provides tons of IOPS so that you can connect many compute nodes to storage. We hope we have made a clear case for disaggregated storage. While some islands that bind together compute and storage may remain, it is our belief that most data centers of all sizes will progressively move to disaggregated storage.